Students, this is the first part of the two-part lecture series on HIV. In this part, we will be dealing with the morphology, the genomic structure, pathogenesis, and clinical features of HIV. HIV, human immunodeficiency virus. It has been 39 years since this virus has been discovered. But unfortunately, the irony today is that in spite of this virus being inactivated completely by treatment with commonly used household disinfectants like household bleach, ethanol, or isopropanol, still this continues to evade the host immune response. And even to this date, we do not have a vaccine against this particular infection, which has been endemic since the year 1981 when it was first discovered. The reason for this evasion of host immune response is that this particular virus has got an extensive antigenic diversity because of high rates of mutation in one of its principal components of its cell wall. So, this particular report was published in the CDC's weekly bulletin, Morbidity and Mortality Report, in the year 1981. This year was 1981, and the report clearly mentions that there has been an unusual occurrence of rare and hitherto unreported malignancies like Kaposi's sarcoma and also other infections like pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. Of course, now it is Pneumocystis jirovecii, but in those days it was still called as carinii pneumonia among male homosexuals in the US. So this published report was the first report that triggered the discovery of this virus. If you look at the timeline of discovery of the virus, we will understand that in 1981, as was mentioned in the report, Kaposi's sarcoma and Pneumocystis jirovecii pneumonia were almost indicated as the AIDS-defining illnesses. Subsequently, on further analysis of the clinical symptoms in these homosexual individuals, the word AIDS was first coined in the year 1982. AIDS stands for Acquired Immunodeficiency Syndrome. It was also interestingly called as the Slim disease because in this particular infection, the people had an extensive or a profound weight loss of greater than 50% of their body weight. Later on, in the year 1983, one of its pioneers or pioneer discoverers of HIV infection, Dr. Luc Montagnier of the Pasteur Institute, isolated the virus from the cell culture obtained from the lymph node biopsy of a 33-year-old male homosexual. As this particular virus was associated with lymphadenopathy, he coined it as the lymphadenopathy associated virus. Immediately in the very next year, Dr. Robert Gallo, another co-discoverer of HIV at the National Cancer Institute, Bethesda, Maryland, isolated a similar virus with similar morphology in the infected T cells of the homosexuals. As retroviruses were beginning to be discovered during that particular time period, and HTLV or human T cell lymphotrophic viruses 1 and 2 were already named by then. He termed this particular virus as HTLV-3 or Human T Cell Lymphotropic Virus 3. Later on, the International Committee of Virus Nomenclature in 1985 concluded that both HTLV-3 and LAV were the same virus, and they have renamed it in the very next year as HIV or Human Immunodeficiency Virus. HIV-1 was named in this manner, and around 1985 another species called HIV-2 was simultaneously discovered from the serological sample of a patient from Cape Verdean in Senegal. So these are the two discoverers, Dr. Luc Montagnier and Dr. Robert Gallo, credited with the discovery of this virus. Where did the HIV virus come from? Was it there in the environment, or did we acquire it from some external source? Well, the answer is simple. As is the case of any virus causing epidemic, endemic or a pandemic, this particular virus also has originated from the primates, and from the primates this virus has jumped the species barrier and has infected the human beings. If you look at the comparison of both the species HIV 1 and 2, you will note that HIV-1 has got a high virulence and transmissibility when compared to that of HIV-2. HIV-1 has been isolated from the primate source common chimpanzee, which is scientifically called pan-troglodytes. This particular virus has got a global distribution, whereas HIV-2 has a comparatively lower virulence and transmissibility and has been supposed to have originated from the sooty mangabeys Cercocebus atus. This particular genus HIV-2 is predominantly localized in the West African countries. It is believed that even before 1981, this virus, which was called as the SIV, simian immunodeficiency virus, was present in the humans as they were venturing into the forest to seek blood and also to hunt the chimpanzees. So over a period of time, since the entry of the virus into the humans, this virus has successfully managed to adapt itself to the human host. UNAIDS, United Nations Action Council for HIV and AIDS, is the international organization entrusted with the responsibility of monitoring and surveillance of HIV epidemic across the globe. In its latest report, as per 2019 census, we can here clearly note that there are about 38 million individuals living with HIV as of 2019. These people are also abbreviated as PLHA, people living with HIV. The number of newly infected cases stands at 1.7 million, and you have an equal, almost equal number of deaths in the same year. If you look at the gender-wise distribution, we can easily conclude that the proportion of this virus in the males, 19.2 million, slightly higher than that of the females, 17 million. In the children, there are about 1.8 million people living with HIV as of 2019. Unfortunately, even in this year, 2019, sorry, till the last year, East and Southern African countries had to bear the brunt of this particular infection. It has been estimated that almost 1 in 4 new HIV positive individual in these countries is either an adolescent girl or a young woman. 9% of infections have been seen in the children and 62% of them among new adults among the high risk group. So as is evident from this statistic, you can clearly note here that around 6.7% of adults are having or harboring this virus in the age group of 15 to 49 years of age. What is the Indian scene? Thanks to Dr. Suniti Solomon, the first AIDS case in India was reported in May 1986 from Chennai. From that time onwards, the cases of HIV have been steadily spiraling upwards. And as of UNAIDS report in the year 2006, there were about 5.7 million people in India at that time, higher than in any other countries. But luckily, the present scenario is much more comforting, because if you look at the year 2019, these are the statistical facts or figures from the NACO report, or the National AIDS Control Organization report of 2019. So in India, this is the organization which is doing the same job as that of UNAIDS worldwide. So as per this report, we can clearly see here a steady decline since 2010 onwards. It has been estimated that the percentage has been around 37% of decline since the year 2010. So currently, where do we stand? What is the status as of 2019? Here it clearly shows that the prevalence of the infection, that is the number of people infected per 1,000 population, stands at 0.22% among the 15 to 49 age group. The newer cases per 1,000 uninfected population stands at 0.05%. If you look at the state-wise breakup, it is clearly shown here that states like Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Uttar Pradesh, Karnataka especially, these three states are having a case load of greater than 10% of individuals. But if you look at the other states, Uttar Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Bihar, Gujarat, have a case load of greater than 5%, and all the other states constitute the remaining case burden of PLHIV in the year 2019. So how does this virus look like? Human immunodeficiency virus. The virus belongs to the genus lentivirus. There are two species, HIV-1 and HIV-2. Both of them cause AIDS. If you look at the morphology, it has got a spherical structure about 80 to 110 nanometers in size. There are two components. One is the envelope and the other one is the nucleocapsid. Now, HIV is an enveloped virus. The envelope is composed of two parts, lipid part and the protein part. The lipid part is derived from the host cell membrane during the replication of the virus, whereas the protein part is obtained from the virus itself during the process of replication. There are two components of this part. The first component is called as GP120 or glycoprotein 120. They are projected as spikes on the surface of this virus. The anchoring or the transmembrane pedicle is your GP41 or glycoprotein 41. Please understand that the numbers indicate the mass of these proteins, which is expressed in kilodaltons. The nucleocapsid is composed of RNAs and enzyme, RNA and enzymes. The capsid has got an icosahedral symmetry. The RNA, as far as HIV is concerned, there are two RNA copies. Both these RNAs are single-stranded, positive sense linear RNAs. The viral enzymes are reverse transcriptase, integrase, and protease. And all these enzymes are closely associated with the RNA. So, this is about the morphology of the virus. So, on the right-hand side here, we have the genomic map of the virus. If you look at the genes, broadly they can be divided into structural and non-structural genes. The structural genes encode for the viral components, and non-structural genes help in viral replication. Now, there are three structural genes. Each of these genes have got a precursor protein molecule, which is cleaved subsequently into different components. Now, the first structural gene is here. It is called as the GAG gene. Now, GAG stands for glycosaminoglycans. The precursor protein is P55, and this precursor protein is cleaved into three proteins or three components. The component that constitutes the matrix or the shell antigen is called as the P18, and the component that constitutes the core antigen is called as P24 and P15. So P18 contributes to the matrix antigen, P24 and 15 constitute the core antigen. Please remember about P24, because in my next part I will be elaborating you more about the lab diagnosis of this particular virus, where P24 plays a very important role. Right, now we go to the next structural gene. It is called as the POL or the polymerase gene. This gene encodes for viral enzymes, reverse transcriptase, protease, and integrase. The precursor protein is called as P31, and the precursor protein is cleaved into three proteins, P31, P51, and P66. The next structural gene is called as the ENV gene or the envelope gene. Okay, so if you look at the envelope gene here, you have the ENV gene here. Okay, that's here. So the envelope gene encodes for the envelope glycoprotein, GP160. This is the precursor protein, and this GP160 is cleaved into two components, GP120, which is the main receptor of HIV, and GP41, which is the fusion protein. Now, if you extrapolate these components, glycoproteins, onto the virus viral structure, we can clearly now understand that the GAG gene encodes for the core and shell of the virus. The POL gene basically constitutes the viral enzymes and reverse transcriptase, and the envelope gene constitutes the outer envelope of this particular virus. So the ENV gene encodes for the envelope, and the GAG and POL gene encode for different components of the nucleocapsid. Now, along with the structural genes, there are certain non-structural genes as well. Let's look at them. On either side of the genome, you have LTR or long terminal repeat sequences. Each of these sequences encode a promoter, enhancer, and integration signal for the HIV virus, which helps in the replication of the virus. Then you have the different non-structural genes. You have VIF or the VIF gene. VIF stands for the viral infectivity factor. It influences the viral infectivity, as the name suggests. VPU stands, or VPU helps in the release of progeny viruses from the host cell following viral replication. This particular gene is only seen in HIV-1. The corresponding gene in HIV-2 is called as the VPX2. Okay. Then we have the VPR gene. The VPR gene is responsible for transporting the viral genome into the nucleus and also to simultaneously arrest the cell growth. Then you have the TAT gene. The TAT encodes the transcriptional transactivator gene essential for HIV-1 replication. This particular gene is increasingly expressed when there is a co-infection with other viruses like hepatitis B, etc. Then you have a NEF gene or the negative factor gene. The NEF gene actually downregulates the CD4 expression on the host cell surface and it enhances the infectivity of the virus. Then you have the REV or the REV gene, which is the viral regulator gene, which enhances the expression of structural proteins encoded by the GAG, POL and the ENV gene. So students, this is in brief the list of or the different structural and non-structural genes which are present in a HIV genome. And I repeat once again before I go to my next slide that structural genes are essential for encoding the viral components and non-structural genes regulate the viral replication. Now, I told you in the beginning that this particular virus evades the immune response. The reason for this evasion is that there are a lot of antigenic variations taking place due to high rate of mutation of the ENV gene. Unfortunately, this is the very gene against which the host develops antibodies. This antigenic variation is because of the error-prone nature of mutation of the reverse transcriptase enzyme. Now, please understand that this is a retrovirus. So, two very important hallmarks of this virus is that number one, it has got a reverse transcriptase enzyme. This particular enzyme is responsible for the synthesis of DNA from the viral RNA once the host cell is infected. The second very important component of this particular retrovirus is that this particular virus is a lentivirus or a slow virus, but unlike in the herpes viruses which remain latent or which do not multiply in the host cell when the patient does not have symptoms, the HIV virus continues to multiply even when the patient does not have any symptoms. Okay, so this is about the HIV virus morphology and antigenic diversity. Okay. Now, there are sequence differences in the ENV gene. And because of these sequence differences, there are several serotypes. These serotypes are, once again, I repeat, are responsible for the antigenic diversity. Please remember that both these serotypes are basically, there are several serotypes, and knowing the serotypes and the subtypes enable us to sort of give a sense of the epidemiological distribution of the different strains of this virus. And not only that, there are certain serotypes which are predominantly associated with certain modes of transmission. Now, if you look at HIV 1 and 2, in HIV 1, there are four distinct groups, M, N, O, and P. M group is called as the dominant group worldwide. But this M group is further subdivided into several subtypes A to J. Each of these several subtypes can recombinate among themselves, forming what is called as the circulating recombinant forms, or the CRFs. So one infected host can have a group of closely related viral subtypes or CRFs at any given point of time. So such a presence of these CRFs are collectively called as quasi-species. Please understand that there is no variation in the pathogenesis, but there is only variation in the geographical distribution and transmission. HIV 2 comprises of 8 groups A to H. HIV 2 is mainly confined to Africa and few places including India, but HIV 1, the different subtypes, as is evident from this diagram, is distributed in different geographical locations. Subtype A is commonly seen in West Africa. One of these countries, Cameroon, you see all the types, subtypes of HIV 1. The subtype B is predominant in Australia, Europe, America, and Japan. Subtype C constitutes the most common form worldwide, and it is seen in southern and eastern Africa, including India and China. So in India, we see HIV subtype C. Now, please understand that it has been observed that subtypes C and E are readily transmitted heterosexually, whereas the subtype B is transmitted through blood and homosexual contact. So, who are the reservoirs of transmission? The reservoirs of transmission are your individuals, the host themselves. The infected person is the reservoir of transmission. Now, I told you HIV subtype C is commonly seen across our Indian subcontinent. As is evident from the different parts of India, you can see that along with HIV subtype C, you can also see some other, you know, subtypes present along with it. But it is predominantly HIV subtype C. Now, this is a study which was done in the year 2012, where molecular epidemiological tracking was done on certain select states in India, and it was noted that several CRFs have been noted mainly in the Punjab and Haryana belt, and also in the Manipur belt, more so in the Manipur belt. But comparatively, in the southern and in the central part of India, the proportion of CRFs is much lower. So, HIV gets transmitted. Who are the high-risk individuals who are prone to this infection? The high-risk groups are homosexuals and people living with multiple sex partners, including prostitutes and commercial sex workers. The second high-risk group is the healthcare workers who get accidental needle pricks and blood splashes on the eyes. Then you have IV drug addicts and drug abusers who also share needles in this process. And then we have people who receive blood and blood products as a transfusion. So, with regard to the mode of transmission, it is very important for you to realize the very important fact that there are two components here. You have a risk of transmission and the most common mode of transmission. Please understand that the risk of transmission is maximum through blood transfusion, but sexual route is the most common mode of transmission here. Okay, so if you look at the different routes of transmission, there are basically four major routes of transmission. By far the most commonest mode is sexual interaction, which accounts for about 80% of total transmission of AIDS cases as per the NACO statistics or the National AIDS Control Organization statistics. The chances of spread through heterosexual route is much more commoner than in homosexual route, and chances of spread through the vaginal intercourse is much more than the anal and the oral methods. The second most common mode of transmission is the blood and blood products. In this context, I would also like to reinforce that this is the route in which there is a maximum risk of transmission. But the if you look at the statistics, the percentage of transmission is much, much lower here. It's only up to 1 to 1.6%. As far as the needle stick injury cases are concerned, it is only about 0.3 to 0.09% through the mucous membrane. So this is much, much lower when compared to the other deadly viruses like hepatitis B and hepatitis C, which also are accidentally transmitted through the needle stick injury among the healthcare workers. So the third most common transmission is the perinatal mode, that is from the mother to the child. This accounts for around 5.4% of cases in India, but globally it stands next to the blood transfusion as far as risk of transmission is concerned. Now perinatally, from the mother to the child, the transmission can occur at any time and even during breastfeeding, and the risk is maximum if the mother was recently detected HIV positive or has already developed AIDS. Please understand that apart from these three methods, sexual mode, blood transfusion and perinatal mode, percutaneous or mucosal transmission modes like sharing of razors, tattooing, splashes of infected blood on eyes, especially which is usually encountered by the healthcare workers during the performance of certain surgical procedures or other daycare procedures following some accidental spurt of blood, etc., has also been reported. In this context, we need to understand the body fluids which are at the maximum risk of transmitting this particular infection. As is very much evident, blood, semen are the two most common body fluids which contain a lot of viral load in them. When compared to the blood and semen, the viral particles in the vaginal amniotic fluid is much, much lower. Please understand that saliva contains inhibitory substances. This helps it to keep the viral load to the minimum number as possible. So that's why they usually say that casual contact or kissing does not transmit this virus. My dear friends, at this time I would like to highlight that this particular virus or this particular infection, more than the virus or the disease per se, has got a lot of socio-cultural implications. Most of the people are outcast from their community or from their neighborhood or even from their own homes. And most of them lose their employment opportunities once it is known that they have contracted this virus. Please understand that shaking hands, sharing equipment, utensils and toilets do not spread this virus, unlike COVID-19, which can easily be transmitted through these high-touch fomite surfaces. It is also important for us to note that just because we are working with a colleague or our friend who's HIV positive, doesn't necessarily mean that we can get that virus too. As I've mentioned, the modes of transmission already previously, it can be easily deduced thereafter that this particular virus is not transmitted through the high-touch fomite surfaces. And therefore, please, please do not discriminate any individual infected with HIV just on the basis of their antecedent exposure. In fact, once they are infected and once it is known that they are infected, we should be the first ones to take care of them, to give them support emotionally, physically, as well as motivate them to kind of rehabilitate themselves so that they can carry on with their normal lives. Now we come to the mode in which we get a HIV infection. Now, please understand that for infecting the host cell, the virus needs to bind to a receptor on the host surface. The receptor which is present on the host surface is your CD4 receptor present on the helper T cells, monocytes, macrophages, Langerhans cells, astrocytes, and glial cells. Please understand that while it is prudent that the CD4 receptor must be present on the host cell and the corresponding target in the HIV, which is the GP120, must also be present on the HIV virus for the binding to take place. It is also important to note here that certain co-receptors are also required for the attachment of this particular virus to the host cells. Now, depending on the cell type in which the infection takes place, the co-receptor varies. If the HIV virus infects the T lymphocytes, the co-receptor is usually CXCR4, whereas if the infecting cell belongs to the macrophage lineage, the co-receptor is CCR5. Okay, so for successful receptor attachment to take place, the virus with the help of GP120 protein coded by the ENV gene must bind with the CD4 receptor on the T cells or the cells of the macrophage lineage along with the corresponding co-receptors CXCR4 and CCR5. In this context, it is worthwhile remembering that there are a lot of mutations occurring in this CCR5 gene which enables a person to become completely resistant to the viral infection, or the progression of this infection to the full-blown AIDS may be delayed. Once the binding takes place, the virus slowly enters and the penetration and uncoating takes place. Before this step, the fusion of this entire complex, GP120 CD4 CXCR4 complex, takes place with the help of GP41 polyprotein, which is encoded by the ENV gene present in the HIV virus. So your GP41 enables this receptor complex to get fused to the host cell, following which the penetration and uncoating takes place. The uncoating enables the release of the matrix protein and also the two copies of single-stranded positive sense RNAs. Now at this stage, I would like to highlight the word positive sense. Positive sense means this particular virus can directly translate itself into early and late viral proteins because they have got the same polarity as that of the mRNA. Now this single-stranded HIV RNA copies are first converted into a DNA RNA hybrid by the help of the reverse transcriptase enzyme present in the nucleocapsid of the virus. Now this DNA RNA hybrid is degraded. The RNA component of this hybrid is degraded by the endonuclease enzyme so that this single-stranded DNA is replicates itself to form a double-stranded DNA. Once this double-stranded DNA is formed, this entire viral genome enters with the help of the integrase enzyme and with the help of the viral integrase and also the VPR protein, it enters into the host cell nucleus. Again, at this juncture, I would like to highlight one more important point. Usually, the dictum is that the RNA viruses replicate in the cytoplasm and DNA viruses replicate in the nucleus. In the case of HIV virus, this is an exception, or there is an exception to this commonly believed rule. Here, we can see clearly that the viral replication takes place in the nucleus of the host cell. This replication is preceded by integration of this genome into the host cell chromosome. This integrated virus is called as the provirus. The provirus enables the subsequent replication of the viral genome. This transport of provirus is enhanced by the VPR gene, which is a non-structural gene, which also arrests the host cell growth. So, dear students, the replication progresses for a variable period. And once the copies are synthesized, the new viral proteins are synthesized, they emerge slowly from the nucleus. The viral assembly takes place within the cytoplasm, and slowly the structural and the non-structural components, including the envelope and the nucleocapsid, is formed, and the budding of the virus takes place through the host cell membrane. And as the virus buds, it takes away a part of the membrane along with it. So this is how a mature daughter virion is formed. As the replication proceeds, there are several factors which affect the progression of the disease. A typical progressor, as per the NACO 2015 document, is one person who develops AIDS within 10 years. And around 80-90% of people living with AIDS belong to the typical progressor category. The rapid progressors, however, develop a full-blown AIDS infection within 2-3 years. And a long-term progressors take around 30 years for the infection to develop. While the typical progressors constitute 80-90% of PLHAs, the long-term non-progressors only constitute about 5% of such individuals. There are several factors You have viral factors like the usage of coreceptors, the presence of mutation of the CCR5 coreceptor, for example, host factors like polymorphisms of HLH subtypes of the host. It has been noted that those having HLA B27 and B57 are associated with slow disease progression. Then we have environmental factors, which includes nutrition and also co-infections. By nutrition, like vitamin A deficiency is linked with susceptibility to the virus, and co-infections like tuberculosis and hepatitis B increase and hepatitis G retard the progression of this particular illness. So this is, in a nutshell, the replication of the virus, resulting in profound immune effects on the CD4 T cells, macrophage, monocyte lineage, lymphoid organs, and the B cells. So the brunt of the infection is borne by the CD4 T cells. Following infection, the virus is carried to the lymph nodes and other lymphoid tissues, where multiplication occurs in these T cells. These infected T cells are destroyed by the virus, and from these T cells the blood spills over, resulting in primary viremia, which coincides with the asymptomatic infection. Or sometimes you can have minimal illnesses, which are common for any other viral illnesses like fever, headache, myalgia, nausea, vomiting, etc. This occurs 3 to 6 weeks after the primary infection. After this acute stage, there is a stage of clinical latency. Now again, I reiterate, as I mentioned, when you say clinical latency, it means only that the person does not have symptoms. It does not mean that the virus doesn't replicate. This stage of clinical latency usually lasts for about 10 to 30 years, depending on whether the person is a typical progressor or a long-term progressor. During this particular phase, the good part is the viremia drops down and the CD4 T cell remains normal. But if the person is not treated, the CD4 T cells start gradually declining. The next stage is called as the persistent generalized lymphadenopathy. Now, in this persistent generalized lymphadenopathy stage, you can see that there is lymphadenopathy which is present in two or more contiguous sites. The lymph nodes are greater than 1 centimeter. This stage has to be distinguished from other known causes of lymphadenopathy. Following this stage, you have the symptomatic infection, which is called as the ARC or the AIDS related complex. Here there is unexplained diarrhea and weight loss of more than 10%, along with mild opportunistic infections. Then the person progresses to full-blown AIDS. Okay, now this is a clinical WHO classification of the HIV/AIDS for adults. Now please understand, the virus is the HIV or human immunodeficiency virus, and the disease is called as the AIDS or the acquired immune deficiency syndrome. Now there are 4 stages, stage 1, 2, 3 and 4, depending on the manifestations of the illness. There is, however, a CDC classification system too, but in resource limited settings this system cannot be applied, because there is a criteria of utilizing the CD4 T cell count to grade the patient into its different components, different stages, that is 9 stages. So we generally in India follow the WHO clinical staging. As you can see here, in stage 1, initially you have the acute phase coinciding with the acute retroviral symptoms. Then you have a latency followed by the development of an persistent generalized lymphadenopathy, which is classified as stage 1 illness. In stage 2 illness, you see two of the hallmark symptoms: weight loss more than 10% and unexplained diarrhea for more than 1 month, along with opportunistic infections like oral thrush, your fungal nail infection, seborrheic dermatitis, etc. In stage 3 AIDS related complex, you have the presence of the three indicator symptoms, that is your unexplained weight loss, unexplained chronic diarrhea greater than 1 month, and unexplained persistent fever for more than 1 month, along with the other hallmark symptoms like oral hairy leukoplakia and pulmonary TB. In stage 4 is what is called as the slim disease, where the wasting is profound, the weight loss is greater than 10%, along with lot of other opportunistic infections. Well, this list of opportunistic infections is usually exhaustive, but I can just highlight that pulmonary tuberculosis, your extrapulmonary TB is the most common bacterial opportunistic infection. Herpes simplex, cytomegalovirus are the most common viral opportunistic infections. Pneumocystis jirovecii, the AIDS defining illness. Esophageal candidiasis and cryptococcosis, meningitis, okay, cryptococcal meningitis caused by Cryptococcus neoformans is the most common fungal opportunistic infection, and Toxoplasma, Cryptosporidium parvum, Strongyloides stercoralis are some of the parasites associated with HIV infections. And along with these opportunistic infections, patients are also prone to develop certain cancers like Kaposi sarcoma, which is other AIDS defining illness, along with invasive cervical cancer and lymphomas, non-Hodgkin's type. These opportunistic infections are also closely correlated with their corresponding CD4 T cell counts. So, friends, this is in a nutshell about the morphology, pathogenesis, and clinical manifestations of HIV. Please listen to the next part of the lecture series of HIV 1. Thank you.